place to start when Nordic walking is with a good warm-up, involving some stretching. Feel free to use your poles and just follow along with Lee's. It's important to stretch the entire body, including the arms, the legs, and the torso. Lee's is showing how to put on the poles, go up through the straps, and then fasten the straps around your wrists. Stretching the back muscles, the lats, making sure that you have full range of motion in the legs, the more flexible you are, the better the range of motion, and the longer your stride length is going to be, especially in ski walking. And then let's coordinate some of the stretching with the upper body and the lower body to make sure that muscles and ligaments are stretched throughout the core. Rotate the joints through the full range of motion. Each joint starting from the center, from your hips, and then your knees, and then your ankles. Do the same thing with the upper body. In this section, we want to take you from Nordic walking into ski walking, ski striding, ski bounding, both in classic and in skating techniques. The following short introduction will show you the difference visually between Nordic walking, ski striding, and ski bounding. Just follow along visually, and you get a feel for what we're going to be talking about. To introduce you to the more advanced disciplines, we're going to take you from a natural progression from walking to Nordic walking, and then we're going to introduce you to ski walking, ski striding, ski bounding, first in classic, then in skating. So just follow along, very easy. So we're gonna start by just carrying our poles. What this does is it starts to just coordinate walking with the poles. Too many people are enamored and seduced by carrying their poles. So what we do is we just start off nice and easy, nothing complicated. Then what we do is we just will start with just striding out a little bit more and now letting the poles just fall down. We're not putting any weight or power into the poles. We're just using them very naturally. Try not to think of them too much. Next progression, we start to put a little bit more weight on the poles as we go, just like hiking. We try not to make too much of a deal out of it. As you feel comfortable with that, what you'll start to do is stride out. So this is ski walking very lightly. We're trying to get just a bigger stride, put a little bit more effort into the poling. As we have that going down, what we do now in ski walking extended, we start to extend the arms and extend the stride. And what you'll see now is the emphasis is on getting that stride length. And this is starting to look a lot more like skiing. In slow motion now, what we're seeing is an extension of the arms, an extension of the legs. This is where we start to distinguish it just from walking. Now we're ski walking. So big extension with the leg, big extension with the arms. Now you have to keep a good bend in the legs, okay, at the beginning of the motion, and then fully extend the arms and the legs. This is an uphill, so there is some limitation on what you can extend. Now ski striding, what we're doing is we're actually now almost bouncing up into the air. It's a difference between walking and running. In ski walking, you have 2 feet on the ground at a given time. In ski striding, there's only one leg on the ground, and there's a brief moment where there's no legs on the ground. So this is like running with a very lumbering, striding motion. In ski bounding, what we're doing now is we're emphasizing the push-off and a more dynamic plyometric sort of push and bound. So there's essentially a build-up and then huge effort in terms of pushing up the hill and then a relaxation in the air. So actually, as you're in the air, you're extended for a brief moment, and as you hit, there's a build-up, plyometric response, and a rebounding action. Arms and legs are working equally here. So this is significantly more exhausting than walking or striding. And this is in the classic technique. To get going with skating, same thing. We just walk with the poles, and this time instead of pulling alternatively, we pull together. And the trick to getting the coordination here is to not to emphasize too much, not get so fixated on where the poles are. Don't put a lot of weight on them initially. Just get the right timing. So what we need is timing first before we start to push. In ski walking, what we're doing now is we're trying to coordinate the poles coming down every time one leg comes down. So just working on that timing. In a full ski walking, in a skating motion, now what we're doing is we're trying to stride out. We extend the leg, we put the arms down, at the same time one leg hits, and we start to emphasize the stride and start to put more weight on the arms. Here from the side, you can see that both arms are working equally, and from the back here, close up, both arms are working equally. Most of the effort is actually the weight bearing down onto the poles. As one leg comes down, it uses the two poles and that front leg are used to pull the back leg up. And the trick to getting this right and trying to mimic real skiing is keeping the weight on the heels and try not to roll too much on the toes. The emphasis should be on pulling yourself up the hill like a front wheel drive vehicle rather than pushing yourself up the hill. Now you'll notice there's a slight asymmetry in the movement. That's because you're pulling on
has one leg on one side, and you can switch to the other side. There's some offset related movement here, but that you don't want to emphasize that. You want to try and keep a very squared off position as you go up the hill. And you'll notice the hips are involved in getting the leg moving up the hill. There's an athletic forward lean as you both come up the hill. So you're trying to stay on the hill, leaning up the hill. Now, we typically do all the ski walking skating drills on a hill because you need to, on the flats it's just too fast, it's just a little bit too awkward. So most of these, the skating techniques are done on hills. Here what you see is the lower body stays down and it sort of drives the poles through. This allows you to keep your weight on the poles instead of it making a big arm motion. As soon as the front leg comes down, the hips rotate and help to drive that back leg forward, and it becomes the front leg, and then it pulls the rest of the body up. Legs are bent, and try to avoid, the hips are stay at the relatively the same position over the hill, the same height. So you're not standing up and going down, standing up and going down. You're staying relatively at the same motion onto the hill, leaning onto the hill, and not leaning back, falling off the hill. I should mention that this particular here that we're showing here is quite steep. Now, ski striding, very much the same sort of thing as in the classic. What this means is as one foot and the poles hit, there's a very dynamic and plyometric response to pushing off and pulling with the poles and driving the other leg forward. And at a brief moment, both legs are in the air. Now, bounding in skating is that much more explosive. And usually you do this in a very, you know, short little sequence, like one or two strides, and then build up. And so what this is doing is teaching you to use the plyometric response and the elasticity in the muscles and to put all your effort into one or two little strides. This develops, you know, that core power. Now, what goes up has to come down. So to start getting used to, you know, coming down a hill, you just walk. Start walking and then a slow movement down the hills with the poles. And this helps coordinate, gets your confidence going. But we don't want to just waste the hill. So let's start to do something that actually mimics skiing. Is that useful for your skiing? So same sort of idea, but we then use the poles as if we would in downhill skiing. So we present with the poles, and we go around them. This is very, very similar to slalom. And we increase the pace. The trick here is, what you want to do is you want to keep your shoulders and your hands facing down the hill as you go. And just like in skiing, you lower your body, and that brings the pole down, the inside pole down. And then you raise your upper body, take your weight off your legs and ski around. In this case, you're running around. So this pole action, this is the same technique that you would use in downhill skiing, except now we have to actually run around. We can't just carve a turn, but the upper body is exactly the same. You do this all summer, you're going to have no problem in doing short radius turns, going down very, very steep hills. You're going to feel very natural, very confident. You're going to have that coordination that you need. So this is what we're doing, with doing essentially parallel or Christie's, lowering the center of gravity, planking the poles. You're planking the poles at the lowest part of that turn, and then you're going around it. The hips and the shoulders stay relatively square to the line of travel. Now, if you're doing, we want to practice plyometrics as well as we want to practice a hop Christie. So in this case, this is a telemark position. And this again is, you can almost imagine that you're on skis doing this. Again, you do this most of the summer, you have no problem doing this on skis. It's actually easier on skis than it is in dry land to do this. Now, I would caution that if you're not used to running downhill and you're not particularly, I haven't done the training necessary for this. This can be very you know, hard on the legs, hard on the knees. So I just work into it very, very carefully here. And here this would be the same motion that you'd do if you're doing, you know, going through moguls or something like this on doing telmark. And you can do also, by switching the legs, you can also do, you know, parallel turns.